Hello, and welcome to your daily dose of Star Trek, a collaboration of Married with Comics, Jon and Maggie, and Batman books, The Dark Knight In Prose, with me, Layne. The Wounded Sky by Diane Duane, Chapter 14. Jim went down on one knee beside Kitty Lick to keep the conversation he felt coming up from giving him a literal pain in the neck. You can do it, can't you?
If you mean can I provide this space with entropy of its own, Kitty Lick said, I think I can. I've broken enough laws in our own universe. I certainly should be able to set them up in this one. It's much simpler.
Much of the command crew of the Enterprise stood gathered about Jim and Spock and Kitty Lick, and around them stood the rest of the ship's complement. At Kitalik's words, an odd, wondering rustle of words and thoughts went through the group, and McCoy leaned down over Jim. Captain, isn't this getting a bit dangerous? He said. First we teach the others consciousness. Now you're suggesting we let entropy loose here too? Won't it be as fatal to them as an entropia would be to us without protection? And even if it won't, consider what you're doing. Turn entropy loose, and time begins as a result. Start time running, and you've done 99% of the work of creating a universe. They, he waved at the brightness, may grow into playing God someday, but what makes you think we're ready for it?
Oh, Lord, Kitalik said in an annoyed jingle. This is no time for kindergarten ethics. What do you think you're doing every time you save a life? Besides, if it's true what they say, that God created us in their image, then how should we not love creating? And how could it be wrong for us to do so, as carefully and ethically as we can, on whatever scale we're capable of?
But Kitalik, creation may not be all it's cracked up to be, even for gods. Look at the state our universe is in.
Leonard, believe me, I've noticed that large parts of it apparently don't work too well. It's enough to make even a god sit on their hands after such a first try. And again, if we're made after such a god's image, no wonder we're chary of playing god ourselves. Once fried, twice shy. But the universe goes on growing and changing every day. Evidently, the gods haven't given up creating. Should we?
But doing it on this scale, with a living being at the mercy of what we create?
I assure you, Kitalik said. If I were to insert entropy into this universe after designing new laws for it, which I would have to do, as you point out, so that entropy won't be fatal for the others anymore, I would be most careful. How could I help it, being made, after all, in the image of the one who was burned? But the choice is plain. Refuse to create, and refuse to grow, or build, with care and love.
She looked back at Jim.
Captain, subject to your command, I choose to build. I think Mr. Spick's right. There is a reason we find ourselves here. I have no basis for that conclusion, but I might propose a possible other side of the problem Spick mentioned. That perhaps the other's course of development in this space was somehow arrested, and without our interference the others would never have hatched into a god.
She shrugged, chiming.
A hunch, no more. In any case, it seems no accident that I'm along on this mission. The question before us, though, is what I'm to do on it. What are your orders, Captain?
Jim took one long breath and let it out, looking around at his command crew. Seeing no better alternative, he said, and paused, giving them a last chance to interject something if necessary. No one did. He glanced down at Kitalik. Go on, then. Found us a universe.
Kitalik shook herself all over, chiming. Very well, sir. We still have a couple of problems to deal with, though. For one, that of power. This is apparently one of the extropic universes, the sterile ones. I said I think I can provide this space with entropy and a set of natural laws that will continue to generate themselves, kicking this universe up a notch, into anthotropy. But to do so, I must reach ahead in this universe's time before there is time, perceive my solution and implement it so that it will be the solution I perceived.
You've been hitting the graphite again, lass, Scotty said gently.
No, Montgomery, I told you, cause doesn't always precede effect. Think of it as dealing a hand from a marked deck, if that helps. In any case, I'm not sure I can do both that and the reweaving of the rent between our universes, which was already going to take most of the power generated by the inversion apparatus. Only the attempt will prove whether I can pull it off.
It seemed to Jim for a moment that Kitalik was regarding Scotty with a gentle regret as she spoke. He looked more closely at her, but she shook herself and went on, sounding as usual again.
The remaining problem is that the others...
She turned a bit sideways, cocking a cluster of eyes at the silent brilliance nearby.
I should not speak of you as if you're not here, she said. You have no experience of time save what you derived, slightly used, from Dehinish and Uhura and Spock. Should I give you entropy, time would indeed begin here. If you had time, though, what would you do with it?
There was no response at first, then a great feeling of confusion and helplessness.
We don't know, the others said. You judge. We will take your word on the matter.
Oh, wonderful, McCoy said. Kitalik turned to Jim, the fires in her eyes swirling blue and hot.
Well, Jim, she said softly for his hearing alone, I've heard it said often enough that our own world sometimes seemed to have been designed by committee. Here's our chance to do the same, it appears, for this is no work of architecture I dare design alone.
I agree, Jim said as quietly, but it could also be our chance to create what people dream about, the best of all possible worlds. Captain, Spock said above both of them, I too would like nothing better, and I encourage careful deliberation. But though we seem to have forever, here, time passes around this zone, and the area of Anentropia surrounds more and more of our own universe. We must be swift. Jim nodded. Agreed. He stood up. People, he said to the command crew and to the other Enterprise people all around, we need to find something for the others to do, some way to spend a period of time that's going to be... He glanced down at Kitalik.
A little less than eternity, she said, though there was laughter in her chiming, as if she told a joke. That's the most I can manage.
Right. Suggestions, then. Remembering that the others are going to be stuck with our solution for that long, what approach should we take? Jim expected to be deafened by a chorus of voices and union of thoughts. It didn't happen. There was some quiet murmuring, and finally the chief of security, Mr. Matlock, said very soberly,
Captain, some of us are feeling a bit out of our league. What kind of time-structuring device can a mortal safely recommend to a god? Our, attention span isn't quite on the same level.
He has a point, sir, Uhura said. The longest-lived of the species we've met have spoken so often of the terrible weariness of their lives. They try everything to divert themselves, and sooner or later just don't care anymore. They're driven to all kinds of extremes to try to amuse themselves. Cruelty, tyranny,
or higher levels of development, Spock said. That's right enough, Mr. Spock, Scotty said. But what can you think of that's higher than this?
He waved one hand at the others, and Jim shook his head. The others' power could still be felt growing greater and greater. Omnipotence, omniscience. They might not have them now, but they soon would. The fact remained, however, that they still had no idea what to do with him, and in an empty universe, neither attribute was much good.
Captain, that was Harb Tanzer. Maybe higher is the wrong place to be looking. And in any case, we don't dare experiment with these people, suggesting something we don't know for sure will work. As you say, they'll be stuck with our decision for a very long time. How about something simple in which they can find their own complexities, raise them to whatever levels they're capable of? Specify. A game, sir. Harb, McCoy said. Aside from my initial response to the idea of a god spending eternity playing games, what possible game is big enough to spend all of almost eternity playing?
The one we're playing, Lynn,
Harb said, quietly, and with a sober smile. The one where you live in a body. You make up issues, good and evil, terror and joy, life and death.
Harb, lad, Scotty said, protesting. Life's not a game to me.
And that's just how it would seem to you, Mr. Tanzer said, if you'd forgotten you were playing. Harb turned back to Jim. Sir, what grander pastime can we recommend to them than life itself? You leave them an out, of course, a point at which the playing piece, the body, expires. Entropy would see to that in any case, so that at the end of each round, the players are freed to remember that this is a game, to count the chips and sit the next round out, or change roles and play again. What would the object of the game be? Uhura said. For a specific person? For starters to discover what piece they were. Once that's handled, and how many people find out what they're for while they're still alive? There's a more advanced form of the game. To find out what the object of the game is. But between rounds, Uhura said, they would know. Certainly, while the game itself is in progress, though a particular fragment of the others is inhabiting a body, inhabiting time, there'd be no memory, or only hints, that it really was a game. That frees it to be played, for keeps. All the value and the things that matter because they're essentially transitory, love, success, joy, is maintained. Even pain and loss lose their sting, because they're transcended at the round's end. The players pass through them and learn from them.
Or not, McCoy said. What then?
If poker's the only game in town, Harb said, you learn to play and win. Or play and lose and do it for the sheer delight of playing. Or sit back and kibitz. The player's free to choose. Lynn, there's a tendency to regard games as not important, not serious. Don't be fooled by it. Politics is a game. Relationships are games. With rules and time limits and restrictions on the players, and there's room inside them all to experience glory and gladness and defeat and triumph, grandeur and intimacy and power and joy, sorrow and love. And those are just the four-dimensional games mortals play, inside the boundaries of life. What could a god do, given a chance?
Yes, the other said in a great crash of thought, hungry and delighted. Life, what you have, the being, the knowing other lives, the loving, even the hurting, all of it. Oh, give us that, and teach us to make more of it ourself. And we will not need you at all. All the time we see in the singer,
they meant Kitalik,
could not use up the possibilities. Give us that game, and go with our love forever. Go quickly so that we can play.
Kitalik looked up at Jim.
Sir, she said, their approval is making this space very malleable. It will accept new laws even more readily than I'd thought it would. I may very well have enough power to manage everything. I think one last time, then command.
Jim thought, while all around him his crew looked at him with fear and excitement and awe, and the air beat with anticipation. He glanced around at his command crew. Uhura was holding her face dispassionate and keeping her emotions to herself. McCoy was doubtful, as usual, but there was a suppressed excitement in him, as there was in Chekhov and in Sulu. Scotty still stood with one hand resting on Kitalik's dorsal ridge, his eyes on Jim, waiting, ready to follow his captain's lead. Spock didn't so much as move an eyebrow, but Jim caught very clearly the thought in his mind. It is logical, Jim. All the same, logic is not everything. Do as you think best.
Do it, Jim said to Kitalik.
And if you can, hurry.
Also, if you can.
That was the others, sounding gentle now, and even a bit sheepish after their earlier violence.
We would not forget you. Will you leave something of yourselves with us? Something for us to remember you by? You have, after all, been playing this game longer than we have. We would be glad of some of your triumphs, your wins, to study between the rounds. And though we see from your minds that we will be mother, father, ruler of this universe, still you are our mothers and fathers in a way, and the only others we have ever known. Leave us yourselves.
If you and the crew wish to do that, Captain, Kitalik said,
I can weave the memories you choose right into the fabric of this universe, along with the natural laws, so that the others will be in no danger of losing them. They'll constitute a sort of collective preconscious.
Do that, Commander, Jim said. One thing, though.
Sir, you said a little less than eternity. Our game back home is only going to last 100 trillion years or so, supposedly, before entropy reduces the last star to a cinder. Somehow that doesn't seem like a very long time for a god.
A good point, Captain, but don't worry. After all, who said entropy was constant? I'll give them a good, long universe, never fear. The others will remember the Enterprise when the galaxies are an old story.
And after that much experience in running a universe, Harb said, they might be prepared to do some modifications on the basic design.
I will begin then, Kittilik said.
Kit, said another voice. And McCoy went down on one knee beside her, looking troubled. One thing, when you write the equations, do you have to give them death?
The brilliance about him was dimmed. So was that in Kittilik's eyes. Their blue belonged, for the moment, more to twilight than to noon.
Leonard, she said in somber notes, you said it yourself. Time is what they need. They can't have that without entropy, too. And death will inevitably come along with that. Rundowns, breakdowns.
You're a creative physicist. Couldn't you find a way to leave that part out of it? McCoy said.
There was a wistfulness about his persistence, as if he knew it was hopeless but couldn't bear giving up.
Let time run, but have it leave life alone.
Kittilik looked at him in silence for a moment.
I could write that into the equations, she said finally. I could write it into those that govern your universe, but I don't know for sure what the result would be, and it would be folly or madness to implement such an option without at least testing it first. There's no opportunity for test here, Leonard. Once I speak the last word, the final statement that implements the equations preceding it, this universe becomes unalterable save by its own types of change, the ones I'll have implanted. I don't dare leave the change equations loose enough to permit easy alteration. Natural laws could start coming undone, and the result would be like the chaos we saw at the fringes of the Lesser Magellanic. Nor do I dare experiment on the others and take the chance of trapping them in some accidental time paradox or some warped causality loop from which they can never be released.
McCoy, silent, didn't move. Doctor, Spock said then, gentle-voiced, you are rarely one for legendary, but this tale I think you know. How did Aesculapius die? Leonard's face went bleak. He was so great a healer, he said, that finally someone offered him a huge fee to raise a man from the dead. He did it. The death gods got jealous. They had him struck by lightning. Spock gazed at McCoy and said nothing. Then hope flared in McCoy's face, and the light around him stirred. And, he said triumphantly, remembering, afterwards the gods were sorry, and made both Aesculapius and the man he had raised up into gods themselves. Yet it required death to bring them both to godhead, Spock said. Leonard, there is a great potential for tragedy in giving the others near eternal time without leaving them a sure means to transcend it. The equations Kittilik means to implant here as the rules of the game will cause them to forget what they are, to temporarily misplace their godhead while alive. How dare we block the only road that we know, or at least have evidence, will lead them back to that knowledge. McCoy looked away. After a moment's silence, with great gentleness, Spock said, Leonard, they will do well enough. They are, after all, a god. And even in our own universe, death has its exceptions. McCoy bowed his head and got to his feet. When he looked up again several moments later, the tears were running down, and he made no attempt to hide them. Can we at least spare them pain? He said quietly. Jim realized fully then how good a doctor his friend was, for McCoy wanted nothing more than that there should be at least one place in the worlds where he would forever be out of a job. He reached over and laid a hand on McCoy's arm. Bones, he said. With entropy and force, I don't think we'll get away with that one either. We're just the youngest fairy godmothers at this christening. What we give can't remove the curse. Just soften it.
If death truly is a curse, Spock said, as soberly as some power pronouncing 100 years of sleep, but with a glint of private, serene humor in his eyes. There is little logic in condemning something one has not experienced, or does not remember experiencing. The group grew silent. Kitty Lick looked from one to another of them, heard no more comment, and finally looked up at Jim again.
Captain, she said.
Go ahead, he said.
Is there anything you need?
For the time being, she said, only quiet.
And to the surprise of most of those who listened, she began to sing.
Afternoon, everybody.
Ryan!
How's that baby treating you, Mr. Daly?
Like Thanos snapping his fingers at my bank account.
In that case, how about a beer on the house?
Sure, gotta give my mouth something to do between podcasts.
Say, Ryan, I don't get how you have so much time for podcasting. Doesn't your wife want you spending time with the baby?
Would you? Truth is, I think she's a little worried about how much time I'm spending with the kid, ever since his first words were Dagobah system. Now she wants me to go out and do something mature, something productive, and most of all, something lucrative that can support the family.
So you're going to...
podcast about Cheers, yeah. That kid's not going to start college for 18 years. I got time. Cheerscast, the podcast where everybody knows your name. Coming soon to the Fire and Water Network.
Captain's Log. Stardate. Early in the COVID-19 dynasty. Okay, so this is my last solo chapter. We're nearing the end, folks. Kitalik's powers of creation are impressive. I didn't know at the beginning of this that she would have this ability. I love that she calls Leonard out on his kindergarten ethics, and she makes a good comeback. You know, when you save a life, you are also essentially playing God. You're changing the course of what would have normally happened. By the way, saying the word Leonard without vowels is very tricky. McCoy's pleas for no death or pain were an interesting insight into his character, who is sometimes one track. He tends to be the one who complains or naysays, and I don't think that's really fair to his character. So I love that Diane Duane kind of opens up his character a little bit and shows this deep compassion that he has. This deep compassion that either he buried long ago under layers of cynicism, maybe he realized it hurt too much if he let himself get too close. I don't know. I'm digging into this, but that's what making a character who is sometimes two-dimensional, making him have depth, that allows the person reading or listening to fill out that character. So again, kudos to Diane Duane for doing that with McCoy. I really love what Tanzer brings up, that his character is the one to say, hey, we don't need some higher purpose. What if we just give them the game of life? At one point when I was reading this, I pronounced recreation as recreation, and it made me stop and think, oh, what is the connection between recreation and recreation? Is it just a regional dialect that I pronounce them differently? Do they have the same etymology? So I'd be curious if the author took that word, recreation and recreation, and connected them like that, because I just sort of stumbled across it by accident. Otherwise, I never would have thought about it. Recreation as in spending leisure time, recreation as in creating this new universe. So the mind boggles. Also, with talking McCoy out of the pleas for no death or pain, I like that Spock is the one who takes him aside and says, look, this isn't really what is best. And it's kind of interesting because Spock, of course, is a being of logic. And that made me realize that McCoy, for everything that he is, being a doctor and an officer and whatnot, he's still very much a being of emotion. Sometimes those emotions are negative,
But that's the interesting foil between him and Spock. And it's not always fleshed out as well as it could be in the television show. I would need to rewatch the new movies to see how they do it there. But here, again, great job. And as for living without pain, there's an interesting medical condition that is extremely rare, but there are some people out there who don't feel pain. I'm not sure if they feel anything, but if I remember correctly, a lot of times they tend to die young because pain is also a warning. It tells us when something is wrong. If you're a person who doesn't feel pain and your appendix becomes infected, yeah, you have a bit of a fever maybe, but you otherwise don't know what's wrong with you until you're dead. Pain itself is not a disease. It is a symptom of something going wrong. It is a teaching mechanism. You know, don't touch the fire, it's hot. So while at first glance it seems ideal to live in a world without pain, there are also consequences to that. But yeah, I just wanted to give Leonard a hug after all this. Wow, what a great look into his character. Alright, that was chapter 14. We have chapter 15 coming up, read by Jon. And then the final chapter, chapter 16, you'll have me, Maggie, and Jon on there together like we did with the first episode. Thank you for staying with us through this book, and happy reading. Layne out.